like a flood.
We are still in the midst of our Bible study and teaching on money matters. And if you don't think it does, then just leave yours with me when you leave the service today, and I'll see you in about a week. Let me know what you think. But money does matter, and the Bible has to say a great deal about money. And we've talked 4 weeks now about this issue, everything from what the biblical principles are to the aspects of credit and getting debt-free and the importance of that. And really gets down to this issue of being wise stewards of what the Lord has blessed us with and what God has placed in our hands. And so we're going to deal with those issues today. There are a couple of things in Scripture we'll read from you from Luke chapter 16. If you want to get your Bible out, it'll be on the screen. But if you want to follow along in Scripture, you can do that as well. But today's part five message of Money Matters is entitled, How to Get a Welcoming Committee in Heaven. And I'll explain that as we go through this, through these biblical principles as we study together. One thing, once you get down, remember one of the first principles of stewardship, which means being a manager of the things that God blessed us. You know, one of those first principles is that God owns everything. The second principle is this. He's called us to handle it. He's called us to manage it. Who owns it? God. Who owns it? You need to remember that. God owns it. Who manages it? We do. And we're supposed to be responsible managers for what the Lord has placed in our hands. So let's look at Luke chapter 16 and find out how to get a welcoming committee in heaven. And he was saying also his disciples, there was a rich man who had a steward. And this steward reported to him as he squandered his possessions. In other words, somebody came, told the boss that this guy's robbing you blind. And so he called him and said to him, what is this that I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be my steward. You're fired. And the steward said to himself, what shall I do? My master has taken the stewardship from me. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. The lights come on. I know what I shall do. So when I am removed from my stewardship, they will receive me into their homes. And he summoned each one of his master's debtors, and he began saying to the first, how much do you owe my master? And he said, I owe him 100 measures of oil. And he said to him, well, take your bill, sit down quickly, and you write 50 on the bill. And he said to another, how much do you owe? And he said, I owe 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, well, take your bill and write 80. And his master praised the unrighteous steward because he had acted shrewdly. For the sons of this age are more shrewd in relationship to their own kind than are the sons of light. So I say to you, Jesus speaks, make friends for yourself by the means of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when it fails, they may receive you into eternal dwellings. He who is faithful in a very little thing is faithful also in much, and he who is unrighteous in a very little thing is also unrighteous in much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the use of unrighteous mammon, who will entrust the true riches to you? And if you've not been faithful in the use of that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters. For he either will hate the one and love the other, or the one will hold to one and despise the other. For you cannot serve God and mammon. You can't serve God and money. Now, if you look in your Bible, if you're looking at these passages, many times in these parables, they have a little title that they put over it. Okay? That little title is something that the translators put in there, just as divisions and breaks between chapters and stuff. It's not in the original text. It's put there by some translator and some publisher for the Bible. And so many of these little things that come over, this little heading over the story will have something like this, the unjust steward or the unrighteous steward. And that is such a poor translation of what this passage is all about, because that's not what this is saying. In fact, here's the Lord commending a guy, and he's an unjust guy. You know, what we're going to see from all this is that there's a lesson to be learned, and the Lord wants to use this guy's life and story to teach us something very important about how we handle all the blessings that God has placed in our hands. So I encourage you today to receive from this what the Lord has for you, all right? The Bible tells us in many areas that our finances and what the Lord puts in our hands, these blessings we receive, are really testing. It's a testing of our righteous faithfulness before the Lord and our loyalty to the Lord. And the Bible says in verse 11, he says, we need to be faithful with money. Faithful is, one translation says, unrighteous mammon. Literally, with the treasures that God has given us. Whatever the Lord has blessed me with in my life, through my job, through the means of which I make a living. that I need to learn how to manage those things in such a way that honors the Lord. Why? Because God owns it all. Two, I'm to be managing all those things. I don't want to be this person. If the Lord looks at my standard of giving and the way I respond in benevolence and meeting people's needs and caring about the gospel and caring about missions and see that my giving is way down here on the end scale, the Lord says, he can't be trusted with other things. Because if I can't trust him with the physical things, how am I going to trust him with the true riches of glory? In fact, to really get this story in clear perspective, you look in verse 15 and it says, now Jesus was speaking to the Pharisees who were lovers of money. And they were listening to all, and the rest of the verse goes on to say, not only were they listening to everything he was saying about money, they were scoffing at what he had to say. So if you find yourself scoffing this morning, oh, another sermon on money, I can't believe, you know, preachers and churches. Yeah. Careful. You don't want to categorize yourself with this group of guys because they were not the kind of people that God wants us to be. God says we should learn how to be prudent. In fact, verse 8 is one of those keys when the Lord says to him, you know, the guys of this world are more shrewd and they're more prudent in the way they handle their finances than the people of darkness. The people of darkness are. The people of the world are more shrewd and prudent than the people of light. Verse 8 is very insightful. It says, the master praised the unrighteous manager because he acted shrewdly, for the sons of the age are more shrewd in relationship to their own kind than the sons of light. The Lord's making a point here. How this man dealt with his problem and his finances and his financial situation, especially upon being fired, and how we should learn how, from his life, to manage the things of our life. Remember, we've already said, the Bible makes it clear that God's the owner of all things. What are we? We're like this guy. We're just the manager. This guy works for this man. He's the chief accountant. He's the bookkeeper. It's his responsibility to resolve the financial issues and make sure that the contracts are handled properly and that they're drawn up properly and they're collected on properly. In fact, the word here for steward here is the Greek word oikonomai, which we get the word economist from. So what is it saying? Here's the bookkeeper for this man's business. Here's the guy in charge of handling all the accounts for this particular man's business. Now, God put us on this earth ultimately to do the same kind of thing. You and I, if we understand all these principles we've been teaching about for 4 weeks already, we will learn we have a responsibility to take what God has given us and manage it in a way that will honor him and will glorify him. God put us on the earth to be the economists, so to say, and the managers. Now, there's two Greek words, two words in these verses that really give us an understanding of what this parable is really all about. Because, again, this has been one of those misconstrued stories. And when people are like, well, it's this unjust steward, and here he is, and you look down further, and what's going on? Jesus is telling this guy he's doing a good job. How can Jesus tell a guy who's an unjust guy, who's an unrighteous guy, he's doing righteous things, when I just don't understand the process of what he's done here? He's telling one guy he can knock off 50% of his bill, another guy he can knock off 20% of his bill. Understand, when this boss is telling his economist, his accountant, to handle these business, he's basically telling him to collect on debts. And the way it reads in the original language is, these have been long-standing. These are outstanding debts. And one of his last responsibilities, once he's fired, is to resolve these debts, and then you're done. You're out of here. So the two key words I really want you to catch to really get a context of what this story is really all about. One is the word diablethi. And it should be translated, when it's talking about this man, here's a man who was falsely accused. In fact, this word diablethi comes from the word diablos, which we get the word devil from. And it says it was reported, remember verse 1, to the owner that he had a steward who was stealing from him. But the word for accused here is a false accusation. It's a condemnation, not based on truth. That's the way the devil always works, though, isn't it? So here's a guy who's getting ready to lose his job because his boss believes what's been told him, that his servant, his accountant's been robbing from him. He doesn't check. If you want a title for it, you'll call it the unjust boss here, amen? He doesn't go ahead and check the story out to see if it's true, but the original language makes it very clear, hey, this is just a lie and accusation. The unjust person's not the manager, but it probably would be the person who told the story, who made the story up, or even the employer who dismissed his servant. This faithful servant on the basis of someone else's lies. So understand, it's important to understand that part of this principle. It helps you understand that part where Jesus is commending this guy in a moment. And then there's another verse in verse 4 when it talks about, and he says, I'm not going to beg. And, you know, I'm not strong enough to dig holes. I'm not going to dig ditches. You know, I'm just not going to do that. I just can't do that. I know about you. Me and ditches, I don't get along with them either. How about you? If there's any work which I hate doing on a little piece of property I own, it's having to dig something, to dig a trench, to put something down. Because I have that soil out in my property there. It's like iron ore and clay. If it hadn't rained, it's not wet, it's like beating a brick wall. You know, you take a pickaxe to get down into it. It just wears you out more than anything else. So I understand this guy's dilemma. I don't want to dig, and I understand the dilemma. I don't want to stand on the corner and beg either. But I have an opportunity here. And I need to be understanding of the situation I'm in. And because there's going to come the day, I'm going to be put out from my occupation. Literally, I'm going to be fired. But the word in verse 4 that uses is for put out is metastatho. And it's from the word metestami, which is used by the Greeks to denote somebody's removal from this life to the next. We use the word more likely he's passed on. He's passed on. This is the word and the idea. Yeah. When I'm passed on from this job, this life that I'm living now, to the next life, I don't want to be a life of digging ditches, and I don't want to be a life of digging holes. In fact, Acts 13:22 uses the same word for removed, and when he's talking in Acts 13 about being taken out of the world. And the basic lesson here is pretty simple. Is when this man is given his papers, so to say, and he's terminated, he's required to collect the bad debts due his master, his lord, before he leaves his job and collects his stuff out of the desk, so to say. And what he does in the process of forgiving and removing, being removed, and dealing with these debts, he goes to these people who owe the money and collects it by getting part of it, because he probably couldn't collect it all anyway. It's apparently they couldn't pay it. He says, how much do you owe? And he begins to barter about what they should do. He has every practical right to do that. He's the chief economist on the job. He made the contract up. He knows what the margins are. He tells these people, you get to take off 50. You get to take off 20. And he acts, the Bible says he acts very prudently, and he acts very, very smartly and very wisely. What's he doing? He's forgiven debts. Now, the lesson that Jesus is trying to teach out of this parable to the children of God and to his disciples are that, hey, it's our responsibility in this life, under the leadership and the headship of Jesus, our boss, as his servants, as his stewards, as the people who work for Jesus. I think it's simple as I put it. We work for the Lord, right? We talked about work and the sanctity of our work last week, and we're given that our responsibility by God, so ultimately we do everything we do is unto the Lord, right? So the Lord's ultimately our boss, and here's what he does. It says he goes out and he begins to forgive the debts that are owed the master before he's put out into the next life. He collected part of the debts due. One 50% discount, another 20% discount. But it obviously pleased the debtors. They're ready and able to pay the full amount. They also not only are willing to pay the particular amount that he's asked them now, they get to the point where this guy now is a good friend. I think I'd be too if somebody gives me 50% off the bill. I'm a good friend. Amen. I'm a good friend now. And it says now they're going to receive me into their homes. The lesson's pretty simple here. We're in this life working for the Lord. Everything we own belongs to God. I'm here to manage it for God. And what am I supposed to do with it? I'm supposed to be making friends for heaven. I'm supposed to be making sure that people understand there's a message of salvation. The gospel is this: your debts have been settled. The sin of your life, the guilt on your life has been settled. Jesus Christ paid the debt. You can be free in your life now because of what God has done for you. So that when we're removed from this next life, the parable is saying, so that they will receive us, it says in verse 9, we'll see in a moment, about eternal habitations. I think one of the important passages there in verse 9, when he makes the point, is the Lord, and the Lord commended, you know, the people. And the Lord commended this steward for doing what he did. The Lord says, people, we went to Christ, in verse 9. Just as this man was granted a relationship, now that we'd welcome into their homes, now we have a new relationship. We're using what God's given us to reach people for Christ, and they will receive us as a welcoming committee in heaven when we die. That's the Greek word eklipto that he uses there, from the word eclipse, because that's really what's going to happen. We're not going to die. We're going to just We're going to graduate to a new life. Death becomes kind of an eclipse for what's going on. But I, behind the scenes, I'm being ushered into a brand new life. And when I get into this new life, what's he saying? There's going to be people there who welcome you into your eternal habitation. I think the unfortunate part about this verse is, the fortunate part is this, when it calls this guy an unjust steward, the way it's translated. And the Lord commended the unjust steward. If you literally break that word down from the Greek to the English, it would read more like, the Lord commended the economist of unrighteousness. He keeps using a phrase over and over about unrighteous mammon, unrighteous mammon. The idea here is this economist, it's not saying he's unjust, it's saying this is just unrighteous mammon. This guy handles the unrighteous mammon for his master. So he's not commending this guy because he's unjust. He's commending him because he handles things righteously and he handles things prudently, even though he's working with unrighteous mammon. This guy's been falsely accused. And now he's saying, now that I've been lied about, what am I going to do after I'm put out from this life to the next life? What am I going to do after it becomes a new world? How am I going to relate? And he starts forgiving these debts. Again, I think another word that gets mistranslated in this whole passage is about this poor guy. And when it talks about the business manager or the economist of unrighteousness or injustice, that's the word adikia. It's not saying that he's unjust. It's describing what he's dealing with. It describes the reward. It describes in one place when it talks about Judas in the Gospels, it mentioned how he took the 30 pieces of silver and the reward for returning Jesus. It's the same word that's used here, unrighteous mammon, this unjust money. It's not this guy's unjust. The Lord's commending him for doing what he did and how he handled the situation. In fact, the Lord calls him prudent. And the Lord, some translations call him a wise servant. Some call him a translation. But the word translated wise or wiser is not really most often translated that word that way in Scripture. It's more along the lines of being translated as a word for being, he's prudent. And the word is phronismos for prudent in Scripture, all right? And it literally means to be a prudent person means that you know how to regulate your affairs in this world with other people and how to deal with relationships. The other word in Scripture, which is sophos, which we get our word wise, is a word which relates to I know how to relate to God. If I'm going to be wise, it means I'm going to know how to deal with God. I'm going to know how to walk with God. I'm going to know how to trust the Lord. That's wisdom. Prudence is how I handle the wisdom God's given me. It's my wisdom in action and how I put it into effect of relating to other people and places and things that God's given me to use in my life. I know how to regulate my business with other people. That's what the word prudence here. I don't know who said it, but I think it's one of the great statements I've read in the past. But he who is managed by God manages his life best. And that's the same idea. If I'm letting God manage my life, that's wisdom. But if I'm managing my life because I'm managing my life with God right, that becomes prudence. Here's a man that the Lord is saying, this guy knows how to deal with people. He's using great prudence here. Would to the Lord my Father that the children of this age, the children of light in this age, or is prudent in dealing with their things that they're placed in their life as this guy did. Jesus calls him prudent. Why he called him prudent, basically there were three reasons. One, he looked ahead. And not only did he look ahead and say, this is getting ready to happen. Then he planned ahead based upon what he saw. And then he acted quickly. He carried it out. He didn't hesitate. Could it be so that you and I would look at the reality of what we're experiencing in this world, not from a physical perspective, but from a place of wisdom where I look to God and God says everything around me is temporal. What's important is you love me with all your heart, mind, soul, and body and that you are responsible in the world, in the life you're living right now to deal with that life and what goes on in that life the way I want you to. Why? Because there's a day coming when we're all going to be put out from our habitations. All right? There's a day coming we're all going to move forward into eternity. That's the day that matters. And so here's this guy, I'm going to be fired. I'll give these discounts. And as I give these discounts, that's going to prepare for me after I leave this position I'm in. And he acts so. What are we doing? We've been given a great responsibility. We have this pearl of great price that has been placed in our hands, and it's called the gospel. It is the message of the forgiveness of sin. It's the message of forgiveness of debts. It's a message of life. And you and I have a responsibility not only to speak it, not only to live it, but to give it. I'm talking about in a financial sense. We have responsibilities to use what God's given us. He's given us to reach other people, to teach other people, to inform other people, and we need to do it, and we need to do it quickly. Excuse me. Four quick things. I had to lay that scenario out for these four things to really catch them. One, I want to talk about the purpose of money, pattern of money, pattern of our life, the pattern for living, the principles that the Lord has for life, and the priority that these things should have in our life. First of all, it's simple, the purpose of money. We've been talking about this a lot here lately, but still I think there is a real ignorance to what it means to when God places blessings in our life in regard to money. All too often we think that we have money because we can get more and we can have more, and the purpose of getting more money is to so I can get more stuff. And so the more money I get, then the more stuff I get. And as I get more stuff, I may get some more money. If I get some money, then I can get more stuff. And thank God for this wonderful thing called credit, because then I can really got more stuff I don't need. Amen? The greatest use of our money is what? The greatest purpose. Jesus said it in Matthew 6, we do not lay up ourselves treasures on this earth, but we lay up treasures in heaven. What should we be doing? We should be saying that as I look at my finances and what God's blessed me with, I need to certainly make sure that this is a portion of this is being used for the kingdom. A portion of this is being used for the glory of God. A portion of this is being used to reach people for Christ. It's being used to make a difference in the world that we live in, that we've taken a message of light and life. I mean, the greatest use of our money is ultimately to get people into heaven. In fact, that's what he said here in this verse. In verse 9, in the King James says, so that they, talking to Christians, will welcome you, that's talking to you, into their eternal habitations. Where are eternal habitations? Heaven, right? The New American Standard puts it this way, into their eternal habitations as well. One's everlasting, one's eternal, but the idea is we're talking about eternity. So I want to use my money to invest in people so they can have relationships in eternity. And by the way, in case you're not sure about it, you're going to spend a lot more time on that side of death than you are this side of death. Amen? You say, how long? I know exactly how long. Eternity. And if you don't know how long that is, I know exactly how long it is. It's a long time. A long, long, long time. And what he said, this guy, he used what he'd had to make friendships for when he left. We use what we have to make friendships for when we leave. There was that song that came out years ago called Thank You, Lord. And if you remember the premise of the song, it was this guy's thanking a Sunday school teacher. This guy's thanking the person who gave to missions. This guy's thanking the missionary. All the people who had something to do with him getting saved. You say, Brother Joe, do you really believe when you get to heaven, you're going to know who those people are? According to this passage, I am. And everybody is. When you get to heaven, it ought to be, woo-hoo! They ought to be excited you're there, not surprised. He made it. That's a shocker. I guess it was by grace, amen. Matthew 6 says, where your heart is, there's your treasure. What happens when our heart is truly in heaven and on the things of God? Then the things that rust and corrupt and that fall apart and perish and rot, those things that don't last, those things we realize, hey, those are just some tools that God gives me to use for the glory of God and for the kingdom of God, and I can be a blessing and see other people get to heaven. That's what a little video we shared at the beginning about what God does with our gifts and our offerings, how they are used ultimately in so many different ways to reach people, to disciple people, to bring people to the kingdom, bring people to Christ. What are we doing? We are making eternal friends for the glory of God. Some of you in this room, you know, if you are here and you're a believer, we are eternal friends in Christ. And some of us are going to rejoice because you had people in this room that had an effect upon your life for the glory of God, but you're going to see how many other people influenced your life. And I think the heartbeat of this message is, God is saying, use your affluence for influence. Use your affluence for influence. That's the purpose of what God's given you. Yes, it's to meet your needs. Yes, it's to feed your family. Yes, it's to provide transportation. Yes, it's shelter and food and clothing. But it's also for the glory of God. And that there ought to be a portion of what I've given that is marked for eternal purposes and for kingdom purposes. That reward is eternal rewards. It's a blessing that goes on and on and on. It's the gift that keeps on giving. Second thing I said I want to look at is the pattern for living. Verse 10 says it very clearly. If I'm faithful what has God has entrusted with me with, he'll give me more. If I've been faithful with the unrighteous things, he's going to give me more the blessed things. Now, we talked about one of the early principles, I believe in Sermon 2 of this series, was the principle of sowing and the identification that we reap what we sow. Whatsoever man sows, that will also reap. So whatever I'm giving is what I'll get in return. But the Lord says here even something more about this in regard to the pattern I live my life. It shows that I'm really being faithful, and if I'm being faithful, not only will I see a return on what I've been given, God said, I'm going to give you the true riches. He said, I'll cause men to give into your bosom in Luke 6:38. I'll make that happen. You'll receive. But even greater than that, and by measure far greater than that, are the eternal blessings of God's fruit and spirit working in our lives. The issue here is whatever you manage faithfully, you know, brings big results. But we have to manage those things faithfully. Some people worry about that 10% stuff and first fruits offering. Listen, you take care of the dimes, God will take care of the dollars. But if you can't take care of a dime, I mean, God's made pretty clear what he wants you to do with a dime out of that dollar. It's your first fruits. By the way, that means before Uncle Sam gets it. Or before whatever little thing else you have tagged onto your salary gets it. Withholdings and FICAs and all the other little subtaxes that come out of the taxes that are added to the taxes that they tax you with on those taxes. But right off the top, first fruits means that it's to the Lord. First fruits of whatever it is that God's blessed me with. And if I take care of that, God says, I'll take care of the rest of it. Yeah. I'll take care of the rest of it. But if we can't be faithful in that, and I know there's 1,000 excuses, you know, Brother Joe, you know, when I made a lot less money, it was easier to give. I make a whole lot more money. It's just hard to give that much these days. I mean, Bill Stafford, the evangelist, tells the story about the deacon he had. Deacon came in whining to him, Brother Bill, when I only earned $50 a week, it wasn't a problem to give that $5. You know, I'm making around $5,000 a week. That's hard to write up a $500 check a week. Bill said, I want to pray for you. Lord, I tell you, take my brother right now and reduce him back to that job where he could be faithful. We didn't have to walk in a backslidden state where he could walk in obedience to you. Some of y'all don't want that happening, do you? Why can't we just be faithful? I mean, it's still a dime. It's still just a portion. You know, if you study scriptures, it's what's required. You know, the Lord says, you know, in Deuteronomy 14, he says, when you learn to do that portion, verse 26 or 27, he says, I've given you that responsibility to teach you, you know, about faithfulness and to teach you that I'm bigger than everything else. It's a pattern for living. It's just being a giver. It's the way we live our life. We become that, and it's not about that health and wealth and blessing and prosperity business. That's not what this is about. This is about you give so you can get, so you can keep on giving. So you can get, so you can keep on giving. So you keep getting, so you keep giving. And the cycle just comes and goes, and you become like that center of distribution for the will of God and for the work of God. Third thing I said I want to share you out of this is the principle of blessing. See what do you mean? Verse 11, the Lord basically says, you know, I'm using this money to test you. I'm seeing if you're going to be faithful here. This is simply a test. What you do with your money determines just how much I'm going to bless your life, is what the Lord's saying. If you can't be faithful with something that's unrighteous, that's right. This is not an eternal thing. It's an unrighteous thing. It's the world. It's not the money itself. It's just money. It's the love of money that's the root of all evil. This is just money. It's a tool. If you can't handle this tool, instead of letting this tool handle you, if you can't be faithful with this dollar, instead of this dollar handle you, then how am I going to trust you with the things that are really important in life? So there's this direct relationship, according to what Jesus is saying, with how I handle my finances, all right, what I do with it, how I handle it, and the spiritual depth of my life. There's a lot of people say, I want to go deep with the Lord, I want to go deep with the Lord, but you won't get past the topsoil over here. You won't break the topsoil by breaking the hold of greed. You've wrapped your philosophy of life around a dollar sign. It says, oh, if I just had more money, I'd be happy. If I could just get this, I'd be happy. If I just had that, I'd be happy. No, if you just be obedient to the Father, you'd be happy. That's where the real blessings of God come. That's where the blessings begin to flow in your life. And there's so many people in our churches today that are just stuck in their relationship. It's kind of like they're dead center. There's no power, no authority. They're just shallow. They're always living on a spiritual roller coaster because they just can't be faithful with the basics of their time and their talent and their treasures. They still want to claim ownership to all their life. You know, you can find out what's really first place in your life, what's really important in your life. You can look at your schedule, how you spend your time, and you can look at your checkbook stubs. How do you spend your money? The way you spend your money, the way you handle your time, are very clear indicators of what is important in your life, regardless of what we say with our mouth. You show me somebody that's growing in the management of their time and their talent and their treasures, I'll show you somebody who's growing deep in their faith at the same time. They're being faithful to God. The purpose of money, it's a pattern for our life, the principle of God's blessing on our life, but there's this priority I don't want you to miss in all this story. It's a priority of loving. We've got to love God. Why do we give? Paul said you give to prove the sincerity of your love. God loves a cheerful giver. Shows the sincerity of your heart. Shows the excitement. It shows you that you understand that your giving is an act of worship. It's just the way you can honor God. God's blessed you, so I want to bless God for blessing me. I want to honor God because He's honored me. I want to take care of the kingdom because He's taken care of me. I want to do the eternal things because He's met me on the physical things. He said, no man can serve or love two masters. He's going to love one, he's going to hate the other. So what's he telling us here? What's the real heart of the problem? It becomes our heart. That's the heart of the problem. Where's my heart in all this? Do I love God with all my heart, all my mind, all my soul, all my strength? If I don't, then I'm going to love something else. Because you're going to love one or two, all right? So I have to choose what's most important. I must choose what I love the most in my life. Will it be God or will it be money? Saying, is it going to be materialism or is it going to be spirituality? What's it going to be here? Money is to be used, never loved. Money is to be managed, not loved. Money is to be handled, not loved. Money is to be invested properly, not loved. But the Lord is making a very clear point here. This is all in red letter for you red letter folks. This is Jesus speaking. This is Christ, the Lord of glory, telling us how important it is that we learn something from even from a lost world. And this guy who's been put out of his job can teach us something. That we don't have to make money our God, materialism, you know, our goal. Even though we live in the materialistic mecca of the world here in the United States, it's so easy to be consumed by stuff and wanting more and just forget about, hey, there's things that are more important than me and more important than getting more stuff. I mean, when is enough enough? When do I have enough stuff? And when am I going to start taking what God's given me of being a blessing to a lost world and use my affluence, as I said, to have influence in the world? Listen, money itself is not good or bad. There's nothing wrong with having money and lots of money. It's when you love money and when you're not faithful with money. God tells us to love Him and love people and use money. We reverse it. We love money and use people to get more money. Put the Lord first. Don't just say it. Don't just have a sticker, but really mean it. And the meaning comes out when there's a definition that is wrapped up in observation. Here's what I'm doing. I'm not just saying. You can watch what I do, how I'm living my life, and you know I love God. You can watch what I'm doing with my time. You can see how I handle my treasures and how I handle my blessings. Then you know if I love God or not. You know that it's more than just a phrase. It's more than just to sing a song of worship. It's reality in my life. And how many of us they're in deep bondage today, could just begin to say, I'm getting out of this hole that I've dug for myself because I've been covetous more than anything else, and I've been materialistic in my mind, and I thought that I just couldn't do what God told me to do. God, forgive me of my ignorance here and my disobedience because you told me you would empower me to do whatever I need to do. And you promised you'd meet all my needs. So I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to be faithful. Someone said if the church in America would just be faithful in handling the prosperity and the blessings of God upon the individual members in the churches, we would never have to ever have to take extra offerings for missions. There would be an overflow because people are just being faithful. It's responsibility that we have to put God first in our life. That really means first in every area of our life. How many of you today even look upon this whole context of giving as an investment in eternity, as an investment in spiritual things? When you make your offerings out weekly, whether you do it on the basis of a 10% first fruits, however you look at it, whatever you want to call it, when you do that, how many of you realize the spirituality behind that? and the faithfulness behind that and the loyalty and the declaration of love that says, God, I love you more than I love this stuff. I'm not going to make excuses. I'm not going to say I can't make it without doing this because, God, I can make it. I'd rather go down failure than be disobedient. I'd rather go out in a flame and embarrassment than be disobedient to you. I want to honor you. I can trust you with my situation. God is saying, but can I trust you to handle what I've given you? Can I trust you? Folks, there's no greater path to victory than obedience. And you need to understand that obedience is always a measure of our faith. That I really do trust the Lord. I'm not being obedient out of some legalistic format or ritualistic thing that we do on Sundays. I'm being obedient because I love and believe God. I give because I love and believe God. I share Christ because I love and believe God. I preach the gospel because I love and believe God. I want to live my life for the glory of God because I love and believe God. That's the bottom line to all of it, is it not? Doesn't that settle the issue? Jesus said you can't love two masters. I don't know, maybe you've been on a job where you've had two bosses. That gets confusing, doesn't it? It gets confusing. There's really only one. And his way is simple and clear. Love me. Love the lost. Love the world. Love others. How do we demonstrate that? With our actions, with our words, with our finances. So understand that the bigger picture here, beyond all this stuff about giving, is you love God. That was the issue with who was listening? The Pharisees who loved money. And they were scoffing the whole time. They didn't get it. Don't be that way. Not only get it, receive it. And not only get it and receive it, live it. Believe God. Let's stand with our heads bowed.